I was forced to leave my wife at, you know, in hospital. It's awful.
He's one of Australia's most iconic songwriters. Bernard Fanning was the voice behind Powderfinger, but decided to call it quits when a personal emergency clashed with touring as one of Australia's most prolific bands. The pressure of being away from loved ones isn't foreign to Fanning. In fact, it's the topic of one of his most famous songs, My Happiness. But now, with a brand new solo album, Bernard Fanning is back. Still isn't it a pity when the night time comes, there's no one in your arms. Isn't it a pity? Mr. Fanning, lovely to chat to you.
How are you, sir?
I'm good. So, where in the world do you feel most creative?
Most creative?
Yeah.
In a room.
Good.
Yes. In a room. So not outside.
So not outside. We're not writing songs outside.
Or in a place where I don't think there's anybody listening.
Oh, why is that important?
It just gives you a freedom to try anything, to do anything, I reckon.
I guess what I was curious about is, what do you reckon the best thing you've learned about yourself since you started making music by yourself?
That's a good question, actually. I would say that I've realised that I have a really good capacity to stick at it and just to keep patiently working at something until it's done.
Yeah.
What I've realised I'm not that good at is quickly working out when something should be abandoned.
Oh, right, that's really interesting. So you just stick with it forever and...
Yeah, I mean, right. Because part of the thing is that you need to think, you need to have the idea when you're writing something that it's the best song you've ever written. So I guess people have that when they're painting or they're writing a film or whatever they're doing. It has to be like a new frontier sort of feeling, I guess, all the time. And sometimes you just have to realise that that's actually not a new frontier, it's just a crap frontier.
Okay, with that in mind, has there ever been a song that you have persisted with and persisted with and it's even made its way onto an album and you're like, probably shouldn't have?
There are heaps of them, but I'm not telling you. Got more than I bargained for. The glamour
and prestige in America. I wanted to ask you about a song you did with Rob Hurst. It's a song called America. I've read that that is about your experiences of trying to break into America. Is that true?
It was more talking about, I guess, when Powderfinger went to America and how equally overwhelmed and underwhelmed we were by the place.
Their CD is called Odyssey No. 5, and tonight they're making their US television debut. Ladies and gentlemen, Powderfinger.
What were your expectations of America? What did you imagine would happen when you got there?
I expected it to be better.
So that begs further questions, right? So you expected...
Yeah, but can I qualify that, please?
Go because for it, yeah.
I would like to make the distinction and say that I don't think America is a crap place. I think the US is an incredible place and has been responsible for some of the most incredible things that have happened in history, obviously. And we had a ball when we were there. But growing up, seeing American culture and being exposed to it and it being kind of like a Shangri-La, I guess. I mean, my experience going there was hilarious.
What? How was it hilarious? I want to know more.
Because we went to Los Angeles, and LA's hilarious.
It is a weird city, isn't it?
It's ridiculous. It's such a ridiculous place.
It feels sort of highly confected, like it's slightly made up. Like it
well, and Hollywood itself, this place that announces itself as glamorous and prestigious, and you go there, and it's mostly homeless people.
Yeah.
It's kind of, it's just bizarre.
Yeah.
Our third, final and biggest announcement today is that the Sunsets Tour will be Powderfinger's last ever run of shows. We've decided after much deliberation and agonising that after this final tour we will call it a day as a recording and touring band.
I know you've talked a lot about the ending of Powderfinger ad nauseam, so I get that. But the part I didn't realise was that, until I sort of went back and reread this, was that it happened after your wife had open heart surgery. What is that moment like when you realise that your wife's recovering from open heart surgery and you are on the other side of the world having to play with a band? What's that mental process like?
It's awful. It was a terrible time. I mean, it was something that I was obligated to, but I realised that I never wanted that to be the case again, where I wasn't really in control of being able to do that, being able to say, no, I can't do it. I was forced to leave my wife at, you know, in hospital. It's awful.
Do you feel like the audience understood?
I don't think the audience had any idea.
Do you wish they did?
No. I mean, no, I don't think it's necessary to share stuff like that. I mean, I also think that it's not that important for people to understand the internal machinations of how bands work or what actors are like.
I think people think it's a soap opera, right? I think the internal machinations, particularly a band, famous band that is ending, everyone looks for a reason why.
Yeah, but that's what they want. They want conflict. They want the conflict in the band. It overrates its importance, for starters, because, it demeans it to a certain extent because it takes the value out of the music.
Oh, yeah.
It turns it into a soap opera.
So you've written so many songs that mean so much to so many people. They're songs that have been played at weddings and funerals. And I was curious, is there a moment at which you have to relinquish control over a song where it ceases to be yours and it starts to belong to listeners?
Absolutely. That's what I liked about music when I was growing up, was investing myself in a song and I would make myself the author of the song and apply my own meaning to it, you know?
Are you ever surprised at how misunderstood songs can be? Because I was always struck by, like, the way people use My Happiness.
I'm constantly surprised by the way people use My Happiness.
So would that qualify as the most misunderstood song you've ever been involved in?
I guess so, because it's one of the best known. A lot of people use it at their weddings, which I guess there's a lot of people that just hear My Happiness. But that's the reality that you've got to face, I think, as well as a songwriter, is that sometimes most of the time that's all the song is to people. It's just something to whistle and tap their feet to. It's only a really small percentage of people where it's life and death for them, what a song is about and how much it means to them. They're the people that you're going after. Really, they're the people that you want to love your music, and, you know, that's what it was for me as well. When I was listening to David Bowie or Kiss or Led Zeppelin or whatever when I was growing up, it meant everything.
Bernard Fanning, what an absolute pleasure you are to talk to.
Thanks, mate.
Thanks so much for your time.
Thanks.
Cheers.
Cheers.